Guest of honor, Dr. Avinash Supe, and all the students to today's 141st convocation ceremony at the College of Physicians and Surgeons of Mumbai. I request Mr. Mohandas to welcome our president, Dr. Girish Maindarkar. I request our president, Dr. Girish Maindarkar, to welcome today's chief guest, Dr. Avinash Supe. requesting Mrs. Bharti to welcome our Vice President, Dr. Farham Irani. I request Mrs. Hema to welcome Controller of Examination, Dr. L. N. Vora. I request Mrs. Arpana to welcome Registrar Dr. Rajesh Dharade. Requesting Mrs. Akshaya and Mrs. Rasika to welcome all the council members. Thank you. I request Ms. Aarti and Ms. Megha to welcome our guests seated on the front row. Thank you. I now request the President, Office Bearers, and our Chief Guest to come forward for the lighting of the lamp. Thank you. Can we have a round of applause for them, please? I welcome the guests who have just entered. Thank you. May I now call upon Dr. Meghna Andankar to give us a brief introduction to our chief guest for today, Dr. Avinash Supe.
A very good afternoon to all the dignitaries on the dais, off the dais, students, staff members of the CPS, and my dear friends. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce our chief guest for today's function, Dr. Avinash Nivritti Supe. Sir has a long and exhaustive list of degrees to his credit and is presently the Dean of GS Medical College and KEM Hospital and a professor of surgical gastroenterology at KEM. He is the director of GSMC Fimer Regional Institute and also co-chairs the Department of Medical Education, MUHS. He is currently the secretary-elect of the Asia-Pacific Hepatobiliary and Pancreatic Associations. He has also been the past president of the Indian chapter of Indian Association of Hepatobiliary and Pancreatic Associations and Academy of Health Professions Educators. He is a member of the Ministry of Health Committee of Reforms and the chairman of Reconciliation Board of the Medical Council of India. He is also the chairman of GI Surgery Board of the NBE. He is an excellent orator and is a recipient of more than 37 awards and medals. He has also delivered the prestigious Dr. G.M. Phadke and Amasi orations. He has various first author publications in national and international journals. He is a faculty for various workshops and courses and has given more than 350 presentations across the world. Friends, the list of his academic achievements is endless, but this is a gist of the various achievements of this great man. Apart from his academic achievements, one must not forget that he is an excellent human being of a very understanding and compassionate nature and is ever ready to lend a helping hand to those in need, not to forget his students. With this short introduction, I now request Supe sir to please address this audience. Thank you.
Honorable President Dr. Girish Mahendrekar, Vice President Dr. Farah, all the council members, all the guests who have really come, all the students who are going to get graduate today, and ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, let me tell you, I really feel this is a great honor for me to be here, and I really thank the council and the president to invite me here as trying to give a chief guest for the convocation address. I have wonderful memories of this institution. Somewhere in 1978, this building was not there, it was only a ground floor. And I appeared for my first member of College of Physicians and Surgeons, and that time I had not even passed my MBBS. And it was something like a prelim exam for me, in this hall I really did. And then later on, somewhere in 1983-84, I appeared for FCPS. And since then, I've been faculty here, coming here very often. But in last 5 to 10 years, I've really seen this institution growing, not only in the size and into the height, but also the academic kind of a growth of this institution is definitely, we need to really take into account and congratulate the whole council. This now is recognized not by the state of Maharashtra and Gujarat, but also Rajasthan, Chhattisgarh, and I'm sure it will have many more states will recognize this, and this will be an academic kind of an hub for many people who want to develop their skills. At the outset, let me tell you that we all today are in a situation where we need to develop a skill-based kind of an education. We have almost about 62,000 students who pass MBBS every year. And if you really look, there are not more than 10 or 12,000 UG seats which are usually there in this particular good seats through MCI or through NEET. And therefore, a lot of people lack in developing a skill opportunity. And there is a need for developing the skill opportunity through various available the health services which are there with us. And that is what exactly with the purpose this hospital, this kind of a college has started. This college has a great tradition. More than 104 years, today is 141st convocation. It's a long tradition. It has seen many stalwarts who have been here. I have listened to wonderful talks of people into this kind of an hall. And that's what I feel this tradition needs to be continued so that the skill development kind of this continues to happen over years. One of the things I always realize that when you come to a convocation, in Marathi it is called as a Dikshanta Samaroh. And what is actually Dikshanta Samaroh? It's very interesting to really understand what is all this. Shiksha is Shikshan. Diksha is when somebody really goes to the Guru and he really says that I want to learn something from you. It was a wonderful situation of education which was there in our country, and all of us must be very proud of that educational system. I don't know how many of you really understand this, but one of the Veda, when we say Veda, it is Vadati Te Veda. And when the Veds were really said by the Rishis, that was mainly a kind of an honor for the God, when there is to really praise the God. And through that it came Rucha. And those who say Rucha become Rishis. And those who really trying to rhyme, Manana Kartat Te Muni, Rucha Mantat Te Rishi. And after that came Shlokas and Abhangas. And the whole thing, the Ved were really started with Rugved, which had all the Ruchas. And after that, there was three kind of Vedas emerged. One was a Yajurved, which had SOPs, what we call as a standard operating practices at that time. And that was Yajurved. But that was not enough. And therefore, there came something like the applied science. And that applied science came through the Atharva Ved, in which came the Ayurved and all other branches which really came. And when the art came into picture, that was the time the Samaved came, which was a song. Therefore, that time also there was a wonderful educational system which had arts, pure science and applied science. And through that Vedic system, which was a very strong Gurukul system, we had that Guru Parampara, and through which there is to be Diksha. And when Diksha used to end, that was the time this Dikshant ceremony was really conducted. Many of you must have really heard why a Brahmin is called as Dvija. And I'm sure when we learn Sanskrit, many of you may not have really learned, but when somebody says Dvija, why do you call him Dvija? Dvija means somebody who has born twice. And that is something which is interesting. You know, I went into details and I realized that when there is a Dikshanta Samaroha, when somebody finishes his education with a teacher, then the Guru Mata and his own Mata, tachi swatachi aai ani guru chi aai dogha milun tala ek anghol ghalat asat. And त्याच्यानंतर त्याला they used to really ceremonially tell him that now you have become Brahman and you have become educated. And that was what is called as a Dikshanta Samaroha, and that was called as Dvija. So we had a very strong kind of an educational whole tradition. Now somewhere in the 1854, you must all read about this, Lord Macaulay came from the UK. And that is the time he really made his observations, which he presented in the parliament. And he said, unless we break this social kind of a structure, educational structure, the British will never be able to rule India. And that was a time when our this wonderful Gurukul system was really broken. Now, once it was broken, of course, we adopted the whole Western kind of an, a British education. And the base of our education has been a British education. And which is fine. I mean, they gave us a lot of science. You know, before I always feel that medicine was an art when it began. In last decade, last kind of a centenary, it became a science. And this centenary, it is becoming a commerce. So today, a medical graduate has to be a graduate of art, science and commerce. But in that centenary, when we had a British education which really came, we had a tremendous influence of science and technology. British education gave us a lot of science and technology. It really brought the new research. It galled the Western research, which was trying to really bring in on our side. However, it made a lot of difference to our educational structure. It also made difference to the kind of the patient care and the doctor-patient relationship which was existing at that time. I mean, look at our previous kind of an Vaidya which is there, whether you see it in Mahabharata, Panchatantra, or whether you read any kind of stories. The doctor had a different kind of a profile and an image. That image was completely changed over a period of time. And that was a major change which happened in our country also at that time. Though we are about 10 years behind the world, we realize that there is a need to do a lot of kind of this kind of an educational reforms we need to really do. Over a period of time, if you realize, we started working on the knowledge base of our hospital colleges. And almost till about, say, 1990, we used to all have knowledge as our base. That means we used to strive for knowledge. We used to collect knowledge. I remember I am really fortunate today that my teachers like Dr. Vohra and Dr. Jahangir are here. We have taught me. And these are people who used to really teach us. But that time a student used to really look for notes. He used to write down because the books were not available. They were very costly. The notes were not, notes were the probably one thing with which we passed our exams. So the knowledge base became very strong over years. But the next phase came when people say, instead of must know, we should do must do. And then from know, we went to the do. And that was a time when we started improving our skill based. And then they said that there is no need, no, you may know everything, but you are not able to really perform. Especially a student, like a surgeon, ophthalmologist, an orthopedic surgeon. Many times it's not important what you really know, but it's important how do you really perform that surgery. So the next phase came where we started doing must do. And the whole science changed towards how you are going to perform. And then there were a lot of criteria which really came. You start, want to do so many procedures before you want to do. You want to do something before I should be able to competently do. The whole concept of competency-based education came. And the competency-based education really tried to improve technocrats. And that's what happened to the next phase. In last 30 or 40 years, sometimes we have created technocrats, but not physicians. And that was probably some kind of a bad side, or I'm saying the side effect of what we really changed our education. Today, we find, the many times I find little worry, because when I see a young child of, say, age of, say, 12 to 16, you go to anybody's home and try to talk to him. He will never talk to you more than three sentences. How are you? I'm fine. How was the school? It was fine. And then after that, he will go back to his mobile. He will go back to his video game, or he'll go back to his TV. That means we are now glued to become a technocrat, techno-savvy. Everybody probably now runs on different kinds of smartphones, and that is something which is absolutely fine. The technology has to grow, and we need to be better, closer. We need to have all these innovations put into our practice. But what is we lost in all this is the human face of medicine. And that's what I want to emphasize you when you are now graduating today. All of you will graduate today, I'm sure you will have a license to practice. You will go back to the society. What we today lack today is the attitude and communication skills which we need to really develop within ourselves. In fact, this was a felt need by the medical council. We developed one module for them. We call them as ATCOM module. And we said ATCOM is something which is very important for every student. And there is a plethora of attitude and communication, which not only includes only the ethics, it not only includes the kind of communication skills. It's very important from our seniors. What we really learned is how to talk to a patient, how to really develop the trust of a patient, how to really make a comfort patient. This is on one side where you want to be patient friendly, and other side we are bombarded by the pharmacy, we are bombarded by vendors, we are bombarded by the technology, we are bombarded by the whole media. So when you are going to go out and going to be a successful physician, all of you have to first decide what is my definition of my success. Is only getting a very high kind of money, or am I going to be very famous? Is that what my definition of a success? Am I going to really have something in my life which I'm going to really have something which is going to help me? Let me tell you, I am working in a full-time system. I am a full-timer. We get many patients who are Adivasis or people who come from the lowest strata of people. Let me tell you a story of a young lady, something like I remember, she had come to me about 10 or 12, 15 years ago, and she had a colorectal cyst. And she was about 20 years old when it was detected. And as per the routine protocol, we offered her that you have to do open surgery and you have to remove a colorectal cyst excision and you have to do an hepatic jejunostomy. She was taken aback and she says, "No, doctor, I cannot do this." I said, "Why?" Because she said, "If I do this, nobody will marry me." And that is something which we have to all think about, the social impact of every action we have to take. We waited for a few years. When the laparoscopy came, we operated through a laparoscopy. And it was really a pleasure to see that after about, say, 1 or 2 years, that she comes and says and has a baby in her hand. She's married, she's very happy. And now, this kind of a happiness, you can never get by any kind of a money. And I think all of you should really remember that whenever you are working, work for the satisfaction. Work what you like. Work where you think you are going to do good to the patients. Work where you can do good to the society. And if you are able to do that, I'm sure that is something you are giving back to the society. All of us grow through society. All of us grow by holding hands of stalwarts. But when we grow old, it's time to give back to the society. So, in your life, whenever you are walking, I'm sure for first few years you will struggle. First year years, you will try to really see how I can really establish myself. And I'm sure all of us will do extremely well. All of us, you are talented. I'm sure you will find a place somewhere. But once you establish yourself, try to think what you can give back to the society. And if you are able to give back something to the society, let me tell you that eternal pleasure of happiness, you can never buy with any kind of a money or any kind of a technique. And that's what I would like to tell you, that wish you all the best. I'm sure all of you will go back with very happy kind of mind, with something which is achieved. And I'm sure all of you and your parents must be really proud that today you have become a postgraduate. I'm sure the career doesn't stop at postgraduate level. You will grow back, and I'm sure there are a lot of subspecialties everybody has to grow. Everybody develops his own profile. Everybody tries to grow in one field more and more. And the lifelong kind of an education continues. But during this education, think about your social responsibility, think about your commitment, and think about your satisfaction. Wish you all the best, and I would like to again thank CPS for all of that.
Dr. Avinash Supe just gave us a wonderful melange of knowledge on the ancient Dikshant Samaroha and the current scenarios at the same time. Thank you for your wise words, sir. And sir, I am sure we all agree that we are so honored and privileged to have an exemplary figure like you amidst us. Can we please give another round of generous applause to Dr. Avinash Supe?